Alini de Rivera, senior lecturer, APIIT Law School, Access Towers, Union Place, Karambattu. Ms. Rivera holds LLM degree, LLB, LTCL, PG, DHR, and she is a qualified attorney at law. Nalini teaches English legal system, human rights foundation, and equity and trust. She also conducts student extracurricular activities, including court visits and moot court training. May I call upon Ms. Nalini Rivera to deliver her address.
I was conducting a constitutional literacy program on the constitution of Sri Lanka, and during tea break, she approached me and said, "Madam, your presentation was excellent. You told me that I had fundamental rights, but listen to my story and tell me how I can invoke them." Padma was a rural woman living in Talpe, as I told you. Her husband worked as a goldsmith until he suffered a nervous breakdown. After the family was sadly evicted from their ancestral property by her brother-in-law after the demise of their parents, Padma and her children faced severe hardship in the form of homelessness, starvation, lack of resources to fund for the education and for the upkeep of her three children. There are millions of Padmas in Sri Lanka who are victims of indigent circumstances. How should the state facilitate the development of people like Padma and the members of their family and those of similar plight? Is it by using the mechanisms under international human rights law that we attempt to find a solution to their problems, or would it be more effective to go through homegrown channels in search of a solution for Padma and her beautiful family? Economic, social, and cultural rights was focused upon by my friend Vasanta, so I won't be delving into the areas that she explored. But it was the focus of much attention at the Vienna World Conference on Human Rights in the 1990s. Among the major issues that were discussed by the conference at its preparatory stages was, who are the most disadvantaged? Among those mentioned and proposed to be focused upon were the following: 1. Civilian victims of war; 2. Refugees and asylum seekers; 3. Rural poor and others living in extreme poverty; 4. Women and young girls; 5. Children including street children; 6. Victims of torture and disappearance; 7. Victims of racism; 8. Victims of human rights violations arising from colonial domination and foreign occupations; 9. Victims of terrorism. Clearly, Padma's case falls into category 3, that is, rural poor and others living in extreme poverty, and category 4, women and girls who are considered a marginalized group. Can a practical solution be found by claiming relief through international human rights principles relating to the right to development and economic and social rights? Sadly, no. Economic and social rights are not guaranteed as fundamental rights in our constitution, as my friend Vasanta explained so eloquently. Economic and social rights are usually given stepmotherly treatment in constitutions. In the 1978 constitution, it appears in a very hazy way in the form of directive principles of state policy. These principles have been set down for the guidance of parliament, the president, the cabinet of ministers in the enactment of laws and governance of Sri Lanka, for the establishment of a just and free society. I get much inspiration from Justice Ambedkar, the founding father of India, where he said, with regard to directives of principles of state policy contained in the Indian constitution, that the government may not have to answer for their breach in a court of law, but we'll certainly have to answer for them before the election, at election time. The mechanism set up under International Covenant of Economic, Social and Cultural Rights is the United Nations Committee on Economic and Social and Cultural Rights. There's a machinery set up with 14 experts who sit in Geneva and who try to make economic and social rights a reality all over the world. But these mechanisms are out of reach of my friend Padma in Calpe. Although the NGOs from the Gaul area could send a letter or written statement to this committee about Padma's plight, the committee would study that letter or statement very carefully and would do very little to ensure the life of dignity that Padma and her family deserve. Also, in sharp contrast to the ICCPR, that is the Convention on Civil and Political Rights, there is no provision for individual complaints in the Committee of Cultural, Social and Economic Rights. So, since she has no solution through economic and social rights, is Padma a beneficiary of the right to development? According to a noted economist and one-time MP of India, Arjun Sangupta has stated that the right to development is a new phase of human development that combines the human rights approach with programs and policies of development. Amartya Singh, professor of economics and philosophy at Harvard University, has described human development in a nutshell. He says it means expansion of the freedom for people to lead the lives of their choice with the removal of obstacles such as hunger, malnutrition, ill health, illiteracy, and economic insecurities. Development is then defined as expansion of freedoms. Human rights, on the other hand, are claims that people make for certain privileges and advantages as rights, which society must provide as first priority, because these rights are the foundation norms of society. In the year 2005, President Mahinda Rajapaksa placed before the Sri Lankan people the Mahinda Chintana or Mahinda Vision, which was based on suggestions and ideas of people who were associated with him during his political career. The Mahinda Chintana emphasizes on the need to ease the family burden. It speaks of the Dirya Kanta program for women and introduces the concept of a prosperous village. The Divinaguma Bill was the culmination of the Mahinda Chintana policies. Mahinda Chintana goals can be clearly achieved through the Divinaguma mechanism. The bill establishes a Divinaguma department. It also seeks to establish community-based organizations at rural level and create a district at district level. I asked Padma to come up with 10 other women of her same plight. Within 24 hours, she faxed me a list with the names of 10 women, their ID card numbers. And I, with the help of the monk in the temple close by, with my own hands, taught them painting on saris. The saris I still wear, but it was not laundered, so I couldn't wear it today. So the women enjoyed themselves outside their huts painting these saris. Now this is what the Divinaguma Bill envisages. Community-based, they didn't have a hall to do their sari painting. So when it rained, they couldn't paint their saris. They did not have capital, only the saris that I bought from PETA and the paints that I bought with my personal funds. It need not happen anymore if the Divinaguma department takes over. The preamble states it will affect the social equity through individual, family and group-centered livelihood activities like the sari painting project. It is interesting to note the objects of the department, which are carrying out development activities as may required to alleviate poverty, promoting individual and family group-centered livelihood, economic development activities, and also mobilize and empower people to speed up national development. When you do this all over the island, at every community, at village level, people are empowered. There is livelihood development, there is saving. So naturally, it affects the economy of the country. The department also aims to provide microfinance to develop physical and social infrastructure facilities that may be required for the development of the livelihood of these people. I went from pillar to post asking banks to give loans to this small group of people. They said they have to have a savings account, they have to have some sort of account, they need guarantors. So the Divi Naguma concept is bringing the microfinance concept, making it a reality. A development fund, a revolving fund, where you repay and someone else gets the benefit of that loan. Also, to provide marketing facilities and setting up of marketing centers. I was the sole buyer of the saris. I paid for the saris and I bought back the saris. So now, under this system, a marketing scheme is going to be formulated. An important feature of this concept is the mobilization of Divi Naguma beneficiaries in the planning and management of projects and the schemes for their economic upliftment. The system hopes to create an institutional framework for the development of saving habits and granting of loans. One of the aims is to develop self-confidence, collective responsibility towards society, and develop good qualities and values of Divi Naguma beneficiaries. The National Human Rights Action Plan 2013, which was presented before the international community in Geneva this year, speaks of protection and promotion of human rights, and also refers to the implementation of economic and social rights through the realization of Mahinda Chintana goals. It states that Mahinda Chintana goals envisages large-scale infrastructure development initiatives, revitalizing agriculture and domestic enterprises, providing an effective and efficient public service, strengthen state-owned enterprises, promoting private sector and small and medium enterprises, and implementing rural development initiatives, enabling Sri Lanka to achieve a significant improvement in economic and social indicators. The role of the courts is vital in ensuring social and economic rights, as highlighted in Mahinda Chintana goals. The Constitutional Court of South Africa has played a vital role in this regard. I would not want to dwell on it, but I say, in addition to Grootboom mentioned by Visakha, I would also quote Subramani as a vital South African court decision. These decisions were criticized that they did not do enough and that the people did not get what they expected, but it was an attempt to bring, to recognize, to give judicial recognition to social and economic rights. Sadly, in Sri Lanka, with all due respect to the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka, the Divi Naguma judgment delivered by our Supreme Court was extremely disappointing. The court failed to consider the right to development as a national issue. The judges looked at the bill when considering its constitutionality in a narrow and rigid manner, without giving purposeful interpretation to this bill, which was to be promulgated in the larger national interest. The Divi Naguma concept was targeted to develop the nation as a whole. The Supreme Court erred by failing to look at the bill from the perspective of directives of state policy. The approach adopted by the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka reflects the dangerous belief that directive principles are inferior to fundamental rights enshrined in Chapter 4 of the constitutional text. The Divi Naguma bill was brought for the advancement of the Mahinda Chintana goals to facilitate the development of the Sri Lankan nation in the national interest and in the interest of the security of the state. May I have one more minute? Peace, development, and human rights are inextricably linked. They are interdependent. Respect for human rights paves the way for peace. A happy person, happy families, happy villagers would not want to go to war. Peaceful coexistence is conducive for development. The concepts, therefore, peace, human rights, and development cannot be separated. They are indivisible. It was the duty of the Supreme Court to pave the way for the realization of the right to development in post-conflict Sri Lanka. It interpreted Article 154 in a very literal manner. The Supreme Court failed to realize that planning and implementation is an undevolved subject and that it is a matter for central government. In conclusion, I would like to call upon civil society, media, the professionals of Sri Lanka, the legal communities, to come forward, to place human rights in the center of Sri Lankan polity, and use economic and social rights and transform it into a tool of advocacy and an instrument of social justice, of fairness between communities and individuals. For a country recovering from a 3-decade of war and strife, national security needs to be achieved only through economic stability. The vehicle to achieve sustainable peace and security are homegrown solutions of such as Divinaguma, which is designed to give effect to Mahinda Chintana Accords. I thank you for your patience.